Hi there. The emergence of animal viruses may be explained by an outer to inner body lineup of the host organ systems. Organ systems present macroscopic viral habitats and are at the basis of the infection process, which translates in a virus shedding profile and so determines the virus transmission success. Organ systems go to the heart of virus fitness. Outside, inside, because in the outer body environment, we find epithelial viruses causing acute transient infection. As we move into the inner body environment, the virus turns persistent. The virus host interactivity changes with it. This is shown here for the world main livestock viruses, 36 in total. Viruses are grouped into three, with the strictly epithelial viruses causing acute transient infection, with viruses colonizing the epithelia and inner body causing acute and persistent infections, and with the strictly inner body viruses all being persistent. The corresponding lineup of organ systems runs from respiratory to alimentary tract mucosa, skin, epithelia in combination with peripheral nerves and ganglia, reproductive organs, immune and circulatory system, to virus circulation just in the bloodstream. The 36 individual viruses are shown here, grouped into three from outer to inner body. The corresponding lineup of virus families and virus genome type broadly match. At some instances, viruses pertaining to one and the same virus family show up in two different infection groups. For example, coronaviruses, poxviruses, and picoRNA viruses show up in both group 1 and in group 2. The lineup of the individual viruses is based on the virus organ system tropism and the infection duration. For example, the equine influenza virus in horses causes a respiratory infection abating in a few days. The swine influenza virus in pigs causes an infection that takes up to 6 days, and virus shedding may continue for up to 30 days. Next, the rinderpest virus is essentially an alimentary tract virus, etc., etc. And so we have group 1, the strictly epithelial viruses, and group 2, the viruses establishing also in the reproductive organs and in the immune and circulatory systems. And group 3, the strictly inner body viruses, all internalized, and so no more epithelial transmission modes. These viruses are all circulating in the bloodstream and include the arboviruses. Now that we have a lineup of organ systems, we obtain insight also in the shift in transmission modes and in the changing virus host relationship. For example, the horizontal transmission modes of the epithelial viruses gradually give way to the vertical modes of viruses of the reproductive organs. Vertical transmission brings virus and host together, with the virus host intimacy increasing from one host generation to the next. The utmost virus host intimacy is observed for the internalized viruses, including the arboviruses. So let me recap. We had a look at 36 livestock viruses lined up in an outer to inner body fashion. By contrasting the acute epithelial viruses to the persistent inner body viruses. And we had a look at transmission, shifting from the swift horizontal modes of the epithelial viruses to vertical transmission and transmission via arthropods observed for the more deep-rooted, persistent viruses. And so at this stage, we may ask ourselves, could it be that acute viruses, relying on rapid and major virus replication, are perhaps more host damaging than the deep-rooted viruses, which are intimate with the host and feature a low virus replication rate? In other words, could it be that the lineup of organ systems tracks with a virus host antagonism, mutualism, continuum? Before we answer that question, we should consider some of the major differences that exist among the main animal host domains, in particular the evolutionary timescales. We have wildlife, and with wildlife I mean arthropod and vertebrate host, since arthropod viruses have been evolving for over 500 million years and fall basal to the vertebrate viruses, which for hundreds of millions of years have been evolving with fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds and mammals, yielding an impressively diverse wildlife virus gene pool. The two remaining host domains, humans and livestock, are novel and anthropogenic, or perhaps I should say artificial. For example, the evolution of epithelial viruses of humans has been strongly influenced by relatively recent demographic events. During the Neolithic, humans settled in the more fertile areas around the globe, resulting in fragmented subpopulations that gradually started to increase in size. And in modern times, we see the formation of a global scale host contact network. In the world of livestock, we note herbivores grazing out in the open, and poultry and pigs scavenging around the homestead. It took all the way up to the end of the 19th century for commercial poultry and pig production to kick in, with confinement of animals in ever larger numbers. One century later, we see the formation of global scale poultry and pig production, processing and marketing networks. So let us consider virus evolution dynamics for the individual host domains. For a long time, wildlife viruses have been evolving according to the specifics of the host environment in many subtle ways, not causing damage to the host. For example, avian influenza viruses in wild water birds replicate in the distal end of the intestinal tract. Briefly so, subclinically, just enough to sustain a fecal-oral transmission cycle in and around shallow water bodies frequented by dabbling ducks and other water birds. Also, the virus cold tolerance in subarctic areas helps the virus transmission success. A second example concerns viruses of reproductive organs that have evolved in sync with the reproductive cycle of the host and transmitting vertically. And of course, we have the arboviruses, which have evolved with the ecology and behavior of both the vertebrate and arthropod host. If we look for virus host antagonism, we better turn to the world of livestock. Shown here are 20 viruses that have over the past 150 years evolved as major livestock pathogen. 16 of which were found to cause a generalized respiratory or also enteric infection. And when we have a look at the corresponding host domain, we find that 16 of these viruses have shown up in poultry and pig production, here termed R-type population ecologies because of the boom and bust demographics, contrasting the stable K-type population ecologies seen for the ruminants and equines. Importantly, viruses circulating in poultry and pigs frequently form a mix of mild and aggressive virus variants belonging to the same genotype or species, and so matching the dynamic host availability, with host scarcity selecting for persistent mild viruses and increases in host availability selecting for viruses stepping up the transmission rate. Let us also consider the evolution of epithelial viruses in the human host domain. We already discussed that the strictly epithelial livestock viruses comprise ortomyxoviruses, paramyxoviruses, coronaviruses, poxviruses, and picoRNA viruses. Now, if we look for common human viruses, strictly epithelial, belonging to these same virus families, we may compare the two virus groups in terms of virus organ system tropism. And then we find, for the human viruses, a prominence of swift respiratory transmission modes and flu-like infections. So let us recap again. Wildlife viruses tend to avoid host damage, even the epithelial wildlife viruses. Epithelial viruses of humans evolve affinity with the upper respiratory tract and cause flu-like infections. And epithelial viruses of poultry and pigs may cause generalized respiratory or also enteric infection. And so we are left with the epithelial viruses of domestic ruminants and equines, which takes us back to the Neolithic and overlaps with the evolution of epithelial viruses of humans. Measles virus probably diverged from the Rinderpest virus during the 6th century BCE, coinciding with the beginnings of urbanization. The Rinderpest virus continued to evolve, spreading out into ever wider areas of Eurasia, century after century, causing ever more prominent epizootic waves. Rinderpest virus first entered Africa towards the end of the 19th century. By the way, the virus never made it to the Western Hemisphere. When the virus first entered Africa, it swept across the continent in just 4 years, killing nearly all the cattle and lots of wildlife, mostly larger antelopes and wild pigs, war dogs and bush pigs. To the extent that in the Zambezi River Valley, the Savanna tsetse fly became eliminated for lack of a host to take a blood meal from. In the years that followed, the virus continued to circulate in Africa. During the 1910s, in West Africa, the Peste Petite Ruminant virus, PPRV, diverged from the Rinderpest virus, kick-starting major epizootics in sheep and goats. Now, let me recall that the Rinderpest virus in cattle and buffaloes was essentially an alimentary tract virus and transmitted accordingly. The measles virus in humans transmits via the respiratory route. And PPRV causes respiratory and enteric illness and continues to transmit accordingly. And so we may finally bring together the lineup of organs, systems, virus evolution timescales, host domain specifics, and the level of pathogenicity. The in-the-body wildlife viruses here are split into two to reflect the difference between viruses circulating in just the bloodstream of the vertebrate host and the arboviruses. The level of pathogenicity increases from top to bottom and from right to left. Viruses subclinically shed in the features of wild birds or bats may evolve as a respiratory or also enteric pathogen in humans or livestock. The avian influenza virus in wild water birds replicates in the enteric tract. Mild respiratory influenza viruses have evolved in humans and horses. In pigs, the influenza virus infection is slightly more severe. In terrestrial poultry, influenza viruses cause respiratory and enteric illness. Likewise, avian paramyxovirus type 1 and infectious bronchitis gamma coronaviruses are subclinically shed in the features of wild birds and in terrestrial poultry cause respiratory and enteric illness. The two remaining coronaviruses are subclinically shed in the features of bats, with MERS virus having evolved in the dromedary host as a mild respiratory agent, and SARS-like viruses evolving as respiratory agents in humans. The pattern that emerges is that in the new host domain, the virus evolves infection and transmission characteristics that are typical for this new host domain. Internalized viruses of wildlife, including arboviruses, may also show up in humans or livestock as host. The simian immunodeficiency virus in non-human primates transmits via the intrauterine mode, subclinically. HIV-1 in humans, by the way, a genetically related host, started as a highly lethal pathogen and today shows signs of attenuation, other than through the much improved medication. Chikungunya virus is an arbovirus and in monkeys transmits via the intrauterine mode, again subclinically. The remaining four arboviruses shown here have all become well established in the arthropod host and in part transmit from arthropod to arthropod, vertically or also sexually. The infection in the vertebrate host evolves as short-lived. The pattern that emerges here is that in the new host, the virus slowly evolves to return to the original sylvatic trait profile. The virus may persist in a new vertebrate host, or in the case of an arbovirus, persist in the arthropod host and cause a short-lived infection in the new vertebrate host. In conclusion, epithelial viruses are opportunistic and readily encroach novel host resources by stepping up transmission. In humans, stepping up transmission is about an evolving mild respiratory infection or flu. In poultry and pigs, Stepping up transmission may result from a virulence jump. When epithelial viruses are contrasted to internalized viruses transmitting via the intrauterine mode, epithelial viruses appear to actively encroach novel host resources and settle in, whereas the internalized viruses appear to be pushed into novel host contact. A persistent internalized virus tends to show up in a genetically related vertebrate host. The arboviruses appear somewhat more opportunistic. Finally, when all the above is applied to SARS-like viruses in humans, we expect these viruses, given enough time, to evolve as mild respiratory agents. Thank you for your attention.